Yeah, so anyhow, all of that is all of the announcements for this morning. And so, and now it's time to go home. Yeah, so, all right. So anyhow, I actually was planning a different sermon series. It was going to be on the book of Acts. And then I felt like this week God really kind of stirred my heart to kind of change directions. And we're going to go a different direction. You don't even know that. But changing, you didn't know. So we're starting a new series today. And it's called Stand Strong. Stand Strong. Stand Strong. So, and here's why, is because in conversations I've been having with people in the church and outside the church and kind of everywhere, there's like this conversations are happening that culture over the last 2 years has taken a radical shift, or just a radical shift. And it's like, how do I navigate this radical shift as a follower of Jesus? And so here's what we see all the time. We see culture drift. That happens a lot. It's always drifting. You're drifting a little this way, and you're drifting a little that way. And every so often, something massive happens in our world where there's a radical shift, where it's a complete shifting of gears, and it almost feels like it's been overnight. So what we have is in our country right now, we've had this, or actually in the world, we have this global pandemic that has caused a shift of things that were maybe already drifting in a certain way. It was an accelerator that accelerated things that were already drifting in a certain direction, and it shifted it hard. How many of you guys say, I felt that? You felt that shift. You're like, I felt it. You're like, yep, I see it. I felt it. And if you haven't felt it, here's a couple things that you're like, oh, now I see it. Remote work. How many of you guys worked more from home in the last 2 years than maybe ever before in your life, right? And there was this study that's been going on, looking at the Gallup polls and the Pew Research. 20% of our workforce worked from home pre-pandemic. And at this point in time, well, at the end of 2021, it was 45% of the workforce is still working from home on some capacity. So it went from 20% to 45% in 2 years. We were already drifting that way, but now we had a huge shift in that direction, and it changed things. People are shutting down office buildings all around town. Hey, maybe we can find one of those. sell high, buy low, right? Yeah, so, you know, but people, they actually did some polls, and 70% of people prefer a hybrid environment where they have some office time and some work from home time. Working from home provides a lot of flexibility in what you're doing from time to time. And so most people are actually preferring kind of a balance of that. It's interesting, the animals got adopted more during COVID. There was a 15% jump in pet adoptions during COVID because they're at home and they're bored and they're like, I want a cat. True story, happened at my house. We do, we have a COVID kitty. To add to our existing cats, we now have a herd of animals. We have a herd. It is... something else. So interesting statistics, divorce rates actually declined. I thought it might increase because now you're at home all day with your spouse and maybe like things get escalated, but divorce rates declined by 22%. Puzzles, the sale of puzzles tripled overnight. Everybody bought a puzzle. Sitting at home, what am I going to do? Screen time. People watching screens on devices went up by 3.5 hours per day on average. 3.5 hours per day. Can't go anywhere. Netflix reported massive spike in viewership of people watching. And so, yeah, the baking supply sales quadrupled, which is why we all are dealing with our COVID-19 still, because we've made all kinds of sweet baking at home. Streaming videos doubled. Ebook sales went up 51%. Worker burnout actually jumped up to 72%, which is why right now we're experiencing what they call the Great Resignation. People are quitting at massive rates because they're burned out on what they're doing, because the whole stress of what we just went through in the pandemic has wore them out. In the first 2 months of the pandemic, Home Depot had a 21% boost in sales. Because we're all stuck at home looking at that DIY project, the honey-do list, and we're like, yep, time to do it. Residential electricity bills went up 10%. Vehicles traveled 430 billion fewer miles on U.S. roads in 2020. 430 billion less miles traveled on U.S. roads in the year 2020. Isn't that amazing? Jets stopped flying, air traffic stopped happening, the consumption of oil dropped radically for an entire year. I'm curious to see if they can see that on, like, I haven't even looked, I'm thinking of it right now. Because, you know, they track all the carbon emissions and the global warming and stuff, and I wonder if you would see that in that blip in, I bet you would. You'd have to have seen the emissions blip in what they're doing, right? Because they monitor the air all the time. I'm curious. Somebody's now going to go look that up, I'm sure. Not right now, though. Not right now. So what happens when the culture shifts in a way that's contrary to the Bible? As believers, we're following Jesus. And maybe everybody in the room is a believer. Maybe you're not. If you're not a believer, you should know that what we do is we follow God's word. We follow the Bible. We believe the Bible is God's word. And we're following Jesus. And so what do we do when the world shifts hard in a direction that is against what God's word says? There's things in the Bible that right now, things are going on in the world, and regardless of where you sit or feel on these issues, if you compare them to God's word, there's a conflict. The Bible says that there is a man and a woman. The world right now says there are 72 genders and counting. The Bible says that God is the ruler of the universe. If you listen to what the world says, it says that you're the ruler of your universe. That you are the God of you, and there is no higher power. The Bible says that there is an afterlife that matters after this life. The world says, YOLO, you're only living once. This is your life. Make the most of it. The Bible says live by discipline, live by structure. The world says, if it feels good, do it. There are no consequences, but there are consequences. This is important because the world is moving further and further from God. And we can lose hope when we hear about the crazy stuff that's happening out there. So how can we stand strong in a culture of compromise? How can we stand strong in a culture of compromise? I'll let you in on a secret. This isn't the first time culture's done this. In fact, every so often you see massive shifts happen, things that change in the world that cause radical changes to shift and happen. I think we might be witnessing one now in what's going on in Ukraine. The Vietnam War was something that deeply impacted our country and caused a cultural shift. World War I, World War II. Just as you go just through history, even in the last 100 years, you can name off a handful of events that were cultural shifts. How do we navigate those? How do we understand how to handle that? And how do we stand strong against things that seem to be different than God's word? So, Daniel in the Bible, it's a series on Daniel we're going to do. And Daniel in the Bible was in an environment where the culture he was in was different than the beliefs that he held. So in year 605 BC, this is kind of the history and context, Nebuchadnezzar is the king of Babylon, which is kind of in modern-day Iraq area, in the Middle East, Babylon. Back then, if you conquered an opposing country, you would kill everyone in that country. You would just wipe them out and just decimate them and just kill everyone. That was how you did it. Babylon came up with a great idea, Babylonians, and they decided, well, these people have value. What if we just enslaved them and made them slaves and work for us? And so we'll do that. And then we'll take the people back from their country to our country, embed them into our culture, make them slaves, and the elite people, we'll take them through a process of brainwashing so they become like us. So then the people who are now slaves can look and see that, well, the people that I've respected before going into this are okay with this. And they have somebody from their own culture to look up, and it would actually squelch and shut down some of the dissension that would happen within the people who are being taken as slaves. We can use them to accomplish our goals. And so Daniel, they were conquered, right? And they were brought in, and Daniel was brought in. So if we're turning to the Bible this morning, we're going to start in Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1. We're actually going to burn through. We're going to jump through the first 20 verses this morning. We're going to skip a few along the way, but you can fill in the blanks. In Daniel chapter 1, it says this: in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with some of the vessels of the house of God. And he brought them to the land of Shinar, to the house of his God, and placed the vessels in the treasury of his God. Then king commanded Ashpenaz and his chief eunuch to bring some of the people of Israel, both the royal family and of the nobility, youths without blemish, of good appearance and skillful in all wisdom, endowed with knowledge, understanding, learning, and competent to stand in the king's palace and to teach them the literature and the language of the Chaldeans. Sounds like he's describing the people of City Church. Best of the best, good looking, come on, well educated, smart, funny, charming. I don't know, we might not be the biggest church in town, but we are the best looking church in town. Give you that right there. But he has the Ivy League of Israel. He's taking the cream of the crop and saying, hey, I'm going to take these guys in and start to brainwash them and take them through this process that to acculturate them into their culture. And they had a system for it. We're going to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. And they had a process and they figured it out. They actually figured out it was going to take 3 years, roughly, to get someone to change over. And so they did that. So they started this process and they said, hey, listen, we know you like to read, you know, your scrolls and you want to read the Bible and you want to read what God's word says, but what we really want you to do is actually read our literature instead. We want you to read what we want you to read so that instead of reading what God's word is. You know, they're like, hey, you know what would be really great is if we put that on a nice, easy, portable device that we could just pull out and just scroll on Instagram or TikTok or just click and click. That was funny. Click, click, click. Hey, did you see this one? And click. Oh, man, look at that one. What if we just changed out reading God's word for reading what everybody else around us is looking at? What if we got acculturated in? What if we changed what they were looking at all day long? What if you could keep up with what everybody else is doing all the time and neglect with what God wants to do in your life? I'm not against social media. I'm against social media taking the place of God's word in your life. Let me be clear. It's easy. I am just as guilty to sit there on the couch and scroll for 30 minutes and waste away half an hour and walk away and be like, what did I do with that time? Nothing. I saw a funny cat video that I sent to my wife because she's a cat person. So I'm building my marriage relationship. Yeah, I did do something. Verse 5, the king assigned them a daily portion of food that the king ate and of the wine that he drank, and they were to be educated for 3 years, and at the end of that time, they were to stand before the king. The daily food that they would have been eating and given would have been a sacrifice to their gods. Which means as Israelites, that would have been against their belief system to go eat the sacrificed food from another god. That would have been an absolute, like, such a foreign concept. They would have known that doing that would be like sinning against the Lord, and their conscience was troubled. How are we going to do this? I don't think this is it. But this is the king's choice stuff. Like, the booze would have been good, it says. They're not drinking PBR and like a 40 of Old English in a paper bag. You know what I mean? Like, they're not, they're doing top shelf liquor. It would have been the best of the best. It would have been the king's choice. The food would have been unbelievable. The best breads and the best cheeses, like a whole load of like provolone cheese. It would have been just amazing. It would have been just amazing. And so it's a party every day in the palace. Best food, best wine, all the time. Drink a little too much. You eat a little too much. Start stripping away the old culture a little at a time, step by step. I'm not against cheese, not against bread, not against good food, I'm not against wine. But when it starts to become too much, it becomes a problem. When it starts to become you're drifting from God's culture and you're adapting into the world's culture, that's where it becomes a problem. I think if we can see the tactics of what the enemy uses to come against us, it breaks the power sometimes to see it. And you're like, I see what the enemy's doing. Just the little step and the little compromise and the little this and the little that. They knew it would take about 3 years to change their culture. It's funny, we still refer to the word Babylon, don't we? After all this time. Babylon. And it brings up images of what? Craziness, excess. Nightclubs are called Babylon. Booze is flowing. People are making dead bad decisions. If it feels good, do it. Like this had, Babylon had so much impact in its day. Literally thousands of years later, we still reference to it even in our culture. I mean, what would it look like if we had that culture here? Like, what if you took your brightest young people and sent them someplace for 3, maybe 4 years? The booze was flowing, bad decisions everywhere. Wait, is that college? The culture in college is like that. Anything goes, isn't it? And again, I'm not against college. College is good. Education is fantastic. My kids are probably going to go to college. I'm like heading off the angry email. That's. I'm sure you, nobody here. It'll be some random person online make like a troll comment on there, right? Yeah, don't comment this. I'm not against this stuff. How do we stand tough in a compromised culture? How do we do it? Today we're looking at some of the tactics that the enemy uses even to this day to try to get us to compromise. And hopefully today you can see some of them in your own life and you can say, hold on a minute, I see some compromise creeping into my life and I need to stop this. And I've learned a long time ago, some may do it, but I cannot. You know, this concept of like, some might be able to, but I cannot. Some people, it isn't compromising their faith to have a drink or two, but for others it would be. So wherever you sit on that spectrum, I want you to understand this is, you need to seek the Lord and find that and say, listen, I'm following God and I'm following him. If it's a compromise, don't do it. And what some people might say or not say, right? So anyhow, just, that was free, that wasn't in my notes. Verse number 6, among those were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah of the tribe of Judah. See, culture shifted in front of these four guys. These four men were doing life. There was a battle. They got taken and dropped into the new culture. Everything seemed foreign. Things were out of whack. Verse 7, and the chief of the eunuchs gave them new names. Daniel, he called Belshazzar. Hananiah, he called Shadrach. Mishael, he called Meshach. And Azariah, he called Abednego. Hey, when I was a kid, I remember that story. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And there's like fire and an angel. And I see where this is going. See, the first thing that Babylon did in the acculturation process was give them new names. Give them new names. The first thing that culture will do to you today to pull you away from God is to rename you. That's what happens. Well, I don't know. Yeah. There's a label. There's an identity. A name that God did not put on you, the world will put on you. And so you got to be able to recognize those things and be able to rebuff them. Names are a big deal. Names are a big deal. Daniel. Daniel means God is my judge. And they changed it to Belteshazzar, which means lady protect the king. What? That's weird. They gave a dude a lady's name? You know, gender confusion isn't anything new in this world. And the enemy will try to confuse you and your gender. There's 72 of them now, apparently. I'm confused. And even right now, if you're sitting here and listening to me say that, and you're like, well, that just seems really, you can't say that, Pastor. You've drifted. And you might be offended at me right now. And I can handle it. And you can send me the email and put the comments. But I'm telling you that you've drifted. Because God made man and woman. And if you're at this place saying, well, I was just born this way, the world's already polluted you enough that they've changed you into the culture that they want, not the culture that God has for us in his word. Doesn't mean we don't love people and care for people. If someone is dealing with some of this stuff in their own heart and life, it doesn't mean we don't care for them. You know what I mean? Like, it's not, we don't judging and condemning. But if we're going to live according to God's word, there's going to be times and seasons where what you're doing is against what the world is doing. And this is one of them. And they give Daniel a lady's name. Hananiah. Hananiah means Yahweh has been gracious. And Yahweh is God. They changed it to Shadrach. I am fearful of God. Wait, God has been gracious to I'm fearful of God? Listen, Shadrach. God is not for you. Listen, Shadrach, you should be afraid of this God. He is against you. That they're saying you're changing your name, puts a label and an identity on you that is tearing you down and separating you from God. And for years, people just called him Shadrach, Shadrach, Shadrach. Mishael means this, who is what God is? Saying, my God is so big, there is nothing else bigger. Who else can do what my God can do? What a faith-filled name. They changed it to Meshach, which means I am despised and shameful before God. How could God even love you? Changing of the names. You see, God wants to take away every bit of shame. In fact, God is so good. He sent Jesus from heaven to earth to die on the cross to remove shame. If you're dealing with shame in your life right now, I want to tell you that that is not what God sees and says about you. That's a voice and a lie from the enemy. And has something bad happened in your past? Yeah, but that isn't. You don't have to live and walk in shame because Jesus already paid the price for that because God sees you not as shameful. Christians aren't perfect. I'm not perfect. Just because you've made a mistake in your past doesn't mean that you are now living in shame. The thing about Christians is we're not perfect. We're just forgiven. So the shame's been broken off. We've been set free. That'll preach. Azariah means Yahweh has helped. And they changed it to Abednego, which means a servant of Nebo. Nebo was a Babylonian god. So from God has helped to I'm now serving another god. Have you started serving another god? You see, when culture shifts, you have to remember who God said you are. You have to remember what God says about you. And that your label should be what God says about you, not what the world says about you. The shift is subtle. See, someone said something about you. It wasn't true, but it stuck. There was an incident that happened, and there was something that happened, a decision that was made by you or somebody else that caused great pain in your life. But that doesn't define who you are. You are not a mistake. You may have made a mistake, but you are not a mistake. And your identity is not found in your worst experience in life. Someone said something about you that wasn't true. Have you ever noticed that 1,000 people can say something really nice about you, and then one person says something negative, and that's the one you dwell on? That's the one that resonates. That's the one that you have to really fight to get rid of. 1,000 positive, one negative. Someone called you fat or ugly, or you will never change. You will always be like this. That isn't what God says. If you take on a name that God hasn't given you, you will miss a life that God has for you. If you take a name that God hasn't given you, you'll miss a life that God has for you. Have you ever taken on a name or a label that wasn't from God? You start to believe something that isn't true. And logically, even in the moment, logically, sometimes you will even know, like, I know this probably isn't 100% truth. There's maybe a little bit of truth in it. But this subtly starts to shift and shift and shift. And the enemy will keep throwing words that try to stick and try to build on that. Because if he can change your identity and who you are, he knows he can get you to drift away from God. If you take on a name that God hasn't given you, you will miss out on the life that God has for you. Verse number eight. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with the king's food or with the wine that he drank. Therefore, he asked the chief of the eunuchs to allow him to not to defile himself. He resolved, I'm not going to do it. I'm not. This is wrong. I'm not going to do it. I don't care what name you give me. I will not defile myself. You can call me weak. You can call me ugly. You can call me this. You can call me that. But I'm not gonna. And you can't make me. When you hold true to God's standards, expect to be tested. Because it will happen. Because God's standards are different than today's standards and the culture that we live in. But God is looking for some men and some women who will stand true and stand firm and stand strong on his word. Verse number 12, we'll just skip forward to 12. Test your servants for 10 days. This is what Daniel's saying. Hey, test your servants for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables to eat and water to drink. Test your servants for 10 days. Days. You know, in the Bible, you see that numbers mean things from time to time. And the number 10 is oftentimes associated with testing. 10 commandments, testing people's hearts, 10 plagues in Egypt, testing Egyptians' resolve, 10% of tithe, right? That's testing your heart. As you go forward, it speeds up and we get to verse number 20. And it says, in every matter of wisdom and understanding, because they basically, moving through, I skipped a couple of verses, they get to the place where standing in front of the king and they get tested. In every matter of wisdom and understanding about which the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and enchanters that were in his kingdom. In every manner, they were 10 times better. When you stand strong, your life doesn't just get a little better, it gets 10 times better. Well, the Bible's ways seem a little backwards and a little archaic. Yeah, but I like the results of God's ways over the world's ways. I like the results of what I see, and it's 10 times better than what we see in the world. If the band would come, we're going to wrap up this morning. You see, when culture shifts, you have to refuse to compromise. And we have a decision to make in every environment that we walk into. Am I going to control the room, or is the room going to control me? Am I going to be influenced by others, or am I going to be the influencer of others? I tell my kids that friends are like an elevator. You probably finish my speech for me every day. They are like an elevator. They will take you up. They will take you down. They won't leave you the same. Who you hang out with is like that. It's an elevator, up, down, same. You have people in your elevator that want to take you down. Who's pushing the buttons? You push the buttons. You're in charge. You're the leader. You're the influencer. This last weekend, I said it like this. Are you a thermometer where you read the room and react? Or are you a thermostat where you read the room, set the temperature, and raise the temperature? Because I think that we can be thermostats in every environment that we go into. Daniel was. Daniel was a thermostat. He walked into this environment and said, I'm not going to do that. I have resolve. I will change the world. Will I change the world, or will the world change me? See, God has a name for you. And you can find it all through Scripture. Promise after promise after promise in God's word. He says things that you are blessed and highly favored. The song that we're going to sing, we wrapped up the worship set with it, but the song we sing is singing God's promises over our life. You know, most of the songs that we sing here, I mean, I think all of them are scripturally based, and you're actually singing God's words over your life. If you got to find ways to speak and sing and declare the promises of God over your life, the world is singing and speaking and declaring the lies that are tearing you down. We've just got to be that much more aggressive with how we're speaking and singing and declaring the promises of God over our life. So if you've adopted a label that God hasn't given you, something happened in your past, that label, maybe it's, I can't trust God. I'm a failure. I'm an adulterer. I'm a cheater. I'm a liar. I'm a loser. Greedy. I'm an addict. I'm ugly. People have said things over you that you've latched on to. You'll never amount to anything. You can never change. You'll always be this way. But that's not what God says. That's not what God says. God says, no, I have called you and I have named you and I have good things for you and I have blessings for you and I declare this goodness over your life. God's labels are this: He is for you, He's not against you. He is for you, He is not against you. You are holy and blameless in His sight. You are forgiven and loved and righteous. You are a new creation. You are strong. You are bold. And you are the child of a king. If you take on a name that God hasn't given you, you'll miss the life that God has for you. Church, will you stand with me this morning? Number 6 says this: the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. Listen, the promises of God are yes and amen. The promises of God over our lives. I'm telling you that some of us need to reject some of the labels that we've adopted, and we need to be able to say, you know what? I'm going to sing and declare the promises and the goodness of God over our life. Come on, let's sing this song this morning.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you. His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Romans 12:2 says this: do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. I want to tell you this morning that I hope that God has quickened maybe some lies that you believed, maybe an identity that you've attached yourself to that doesn't need to be there. In the name of Jesus, we declare this morning those things are broken off. In the name of Jesus, that your Holy Spirit would come and invade somebody's heart and these minds and the belief system that we've had. God, we've attached ourselves to the belief system of this world. And God, help us break off of that and stand strong on your word and stand strong on what you've said. Those lies of the enemy aren't true. I'm not dumb, I'm not fat, I'm not stupid, I'm not ugly. I am chosen. I am a son or a daughter of the King. I'm a prince and a princess. The shame's been broken off. The condemnation is gone. What happened in my past happened in my past. But I can walk forward in freedom and knowing that your name for me stands true. That your name for me, what you say, is the truth about who I am.
His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and their children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
Service ahead of time, and they're praying for you, and they're actually on either side of the auditorium now praying with people. And if you need prayer for any reason whatsoever, I want to invite you to come and receive prayer. They actually gave me a few words that they believe God was sharing with them, that God wants to heal some things, and there was something specific about white blood cells, potentially radiation, something, and there's a fear wrapped around that. God wants to bring healing in there. Someone's been dealing with some grief. Someone else is carrying something that's too heavy for them. There's a reuniting of dreams. Somebody here believes they've missed God, or maybe they're mad at God. I want to tell you there's nothing too small. No matter what you're going through, we want to stand with you in prayer. And so we've been praying for you. We continue to pray for you. At this time, we're going to be done with our service this morning, but please receive prayer if you want to receive prayer. God bless you and have a wonderful week.